Everything I'm going to be talking to you about today is 100%, I promise, actually, factually true. I'm not going to make up anything about Superman or the stories or the history. Nothing is out of context. Just so you know, I'm not being ironic. Like, that's just a thing. Okay. So, with that in mind, I want to talk to you today about Superman. And I don't really need to, like, introduce Superman to you as one of the most popular fictional characters in the world, but I'll just kind of, like, run through the basics. Superman, as you know, is a strange visitor from another world. He lived on the planet Krypton with his parents, and then Krypton exploded. So his parents sent him to Earth in a rocket as a baby, along with a super monkey named Beppo. The rocket landed in Smallville, Kansas, where he took the name Clark Kent and became a reporter. And he works for the Evening News, which is in Cleveland, and also the Daily Star, which is also in Cleveland. His best friends are a cowboy named Tumbleweed Jones and Poco, an alien jester from the planet Utopia who only speaks in rhyme, and his girlfriend is a mermaid. Superman, as you know, has powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. For example, he can leap an eighth of a mile, he can walk on telephone wires while holding terrified children, he can mush up his face and make himself look like anybody, he can read people's thoughts and control them remotely, and he can travel through time by running really fast. And also, he can raise up his hand and a little mini Superman will shoot out of his palm that can fly and has all of his powers. I swear to God. Superman, as you know, wages a never-ending battle against the forces of evil, including radio announcers and Nazis and giant apes and the devil and alien game shows and rock festivals. He has an ice castle in the Arctic called the Fortress of Solitude, where he operates a secret wax museum of his friends and loved ones, which no one is ever allowed to visit because he made wax figures of himself as Clark and as Superman, and then wrote Superman, Clark Kent's secret identity on it. And also, seriously, I swear to God, when he was a baby, he had a super monkey. Now, all the things that I just showed you are absolutely true from real canonical Superman stories, but obviously that is not the Superman story that you know, which is very confusing. To explain that, you have to understand how Superman works, which leads us to natural selection. Now, for every environment in the world, there are organisms that have adapted to live in that environment, and people talk about it as survival of the fittest. But it's not actually like competition between different species. It's competition between individual members of a species to see like which one can get the most food or sunlight, or you know partners to mate with, or can run fastest away from predators. So essentially, like you don't have to swim faster than the shark. You just have to swim faster than your friend. And so, like giraffes, for example, let's take giraffes. Giraffes didn't kind of just decide all of a sudden to grow really long necks. It's just that they eat leaves off of trees, and so the giraffes that had like slightly longer necks were able to reach higher leaves, and then you know they would be more likely in hard times to survive, and then you know and pass on their long neck genes to their kids, and then that would happen again like in later generations, and so after many, many, many generations, that's why we end up with giraffes, and that's how comic books work, because ideas can also like evolve and change over time, and especially in serialized narrative like comic books, they're sort of little laboratories for different ideas that can compete against each other for our attention. And that's not just true of comic books, it's any kind of serialized narrative, like a movie franchise or a book series or a TV show, that you can see sort of different story elements competing, and sort of if there's a lot of iterations over time, then the good ideas tend to stick around and the bad ideas tend to fade away. So the question of like why everybody here in the audience knows about Lois Lane, Superman's girlfriend, is a reporter, and not Lori Lamaris, who is a mermaid, who is absolutely like seriously another option. That's because Lois Lane is a really strong idea and Lori Lamaris is a really weak idea. And if we can like understand what makes one thing strong and the other weak, then that tells us a lot about how stories work. Which brings us to Charles Dickens. So Charles Dickens, in 1836, he wrote his first serial which is the Pickwick Papers. Writing serialized narrative is really different from like just writing a book. So Dickens didn't just like write a whole novel and release it in chunks. He was still writing it as people were already reading it. And so that's how like TV shows work, and that's how like movie sequels work, that you're getting feedback from the audience in the form of ratings or sales or like really mean tweets and reviews, and like just hearing, just looking at it and hearing from people about how it's going, that helps the author to sort of shape what's going on and capitalize on what's working and kind of fade out what's not. So in the Pickwick Papers, which was going fine, like in the first, nine chapters, and then in chapter 10, Dickens introduces this character named Sam Weller, who was like a comedy servant character, he talks really funny and he was really cool, but he was only supposed to be in like a couple chapters, and then they were gonna move on to other stuff. And Sam Weller became super crazy popular in 1836, to the point where like people were making, like while Dickens was still writing the book, people were making their own Sam Weller joke books and publishing them. And so he didn't intend for Sam Weller to like take over his book and his career, but he was a genius. And kind of the way that that works is that half of the genius is coming up with the idea, and then the other half of the genius is recognizing a good idea and sort of capitalizing on that. So when there's a story that has like a ton of iterations, you can, like I said, you can see this natural selection happening in real time. That's what happened. So Superman, his first appearance was in Action Comics number 1. It was written by Joe Siegel and drawn by Jerry Schuster. And it's actually just the first story of several that are in that comic. And right from the start, like this was what Superman was in that first issue. He was an alien from another planet which exploded and he was sent away. He was named Clark Kent and he was a reporter. Lois Lane is in the strip like straight from issue 1. And she's kind of like potentially a love interest, kind of a rival. And his powers are that he's really strong, he's basically indestructible, and then he can jump really high. And that's basically, so that's who Superman is from the start. And apparently that was a thing that people in 1938 had just been clearly waiting for. It was the most popular comic book that had ever been published, and was just selling way more than everything else. So 6 months later, they started a comic strip version, which was written and drawn by the same people. And so they were sort of currently doing one monthly story in the comic books and then also doing sort of parallel to that, the same people were doing a daily comic strip. And that went really well, and so 6 months after that, they started a Superman comic book, it's the first comic book that was ever given over to only a single character. They were all anthologies before that. And so that's running as well as Action Comics. And then 6 months after that, so now we're like 18 months in, they started a radio show that was on every day. So at this point in 1938, or I'm sorry, at this point it's 1940 by then, within a year and a half, there are three distinct versions of the Superman story all happening at the same time. There's the comic books and the comic strips and then the radio show, plus there's more comic book stories for Superman than there are for anybody else. And so this becomes sort of this fertile environment and we can kind of see how that works. So the really, really weird thing about this is that the Superman that everybody fell in love with in 1938 is really, really not the Superman that we know. So to illustrate, this is issue number 8. Clark Kent is at the trial of a gang of 4 young hoodlums, and he decides that they're found guilty, but he decides it's not really their fault. They must be good kids. And so he turns into Superman and takes the kids away from the police, literally just like picking up the van and snatching kids out of it. And then he spends a while in the book like just carrying them around under his arms. There's like pages of that. And so through all of this, he decides that they are actually good kids. The problem is their environment. In other words, the overcrowded slum where they live. And so he gets an idea, which is that when there's a natural disaster, the government will come in and build new buildings, new homes for people, if only we could figure out some way to create a natural disaster of our own. There you go. So he just goes in and like he picks up houses and starts messing with them and saying like the government will rebuild this, which is totally gonna work. And he actually, like, those four kids, they go around the neighborhood and tell everybody who lives in the houses that they need to take their valuables and evacuate within 5 minutes because shit's gonna go down. And then he just spends like a really long time just destroying homes. They call the police, police can't do anything. They call the National Guard can't do anything. Bullets bounce off this man, what is this? They call in bombers. Now, like I said, this is not out of context, like this is actually the way the story went. They call in bombers to take care of Superman, and he just kind of like runs around on the ground and says, awesome, keep it up, boys, you're helping me destroy this community. So that by the end, it's just ruin and desolation as far as the eye can see, just completely devastated toxic waste area. And you'll never guess what happens next is that in time, the slums are replaced by splendid housing conditions. So that worked awesome. And that's how urban planning works. So there's that, and then the next panel is one more panel in the story, and it's the editor congratulating Clark on his amazing article about this, and what a great thing Superman did, the end. And that's how Superman was back then. And then after that, then there's issue 12, where Superman declares war on reckless drivers. And I can't even, like, I'm sorry, I cannot tell you what happens in issue 12. Like, issue 12 is haunting. It's just unreal. And so this is America's awesome hero. This is the hero that y'all know, right? And Lois Lane also in that first year, like she's in the first issue, but she's not in the strip very much. She's only in like four stories over the course of 1939, and she's the only recurring character. So it's basically like the first year of Superman is just Superman going on rampages. So after a while, so this is issue 13 now, they figured out a new thing for him to do rather than just destroy people's lives, that they invent this concept of a supervillain. So there's this crazy, bald genius, smartest man in the world, he says, who is gonna like take care of Superman and then do terrible crimes. And his name is the Ultra-Humanite. This is not Lex Luthor. Lex Luthor actually comes in later. This is the Ultra-Humanite. You can tell the difference between the Ultra-Humanite and Lex Luthor because the Ultra-Humanite is the one who dies and then tells his henchmen to take his body and transplant it into the body of glamorous female movie star Dolores Winters. And so I'm gonna leave you just for that for just a second. Seriously, for real, there's two more stories with the Ultra-Humanite fighting Superman in the body of glamorous female movie star Dolores Winters until like the end of the second story, like that when she throws herself into a volcano, like you do. And then it's actually not very many months later, it's like maybe 4 or 5 months later, that Lex Luthor appears for the first time. And a weird thing about that is that he actually is the only person in his organization who is not bald. So Lex Luthor is super exciting, like even more than the Ultra-Humanite, because he is not just like super smart and wants to dominate the world, but also he's a mad scientist, which means that he can invent things like death rays, and all of a sudden Superman is fighting dinosaurs instead of like racketeers and drivers he's taking an issue with. So then the comic strip, so this is sort of now where you're starting to see like elements come together. Later on, like a few months after that, in the comic strip, Luthor appears for the first time and he's bald. So what that is this sort of mingling of ideas that they had for different comic books, and the good ones are actually winning out. So that like a super genius who wants to dominate the world and be a super villain, that's an excellent idea. Luthor is a much better name than Ultra-Humanite, and so Luthor, that's the name of this guy. And being bald is like a much better visual hook than just a guy with kind of like messy red hair. And so that's what we end up with here is Lex Luthor. Obviously like the reason why I'm obsessing about who's bald and who's not is because then this is sort of natural selection at work. Now, sort of as an overview for all of this, there is an ancient truce between authors and audiences that dates all the way back to the days of epic poetry and oral storytelling, and that truce is the authors say, I want to tell you my story, and the audiences say, I will listen to your story, but only for as long as it's interesting. And that's the agreement. Now, when I use the word interesting, I'm talking actually in a really broad sense. It could mean really funny, or really sexy, or sad, or intellectually challenging, or mysterious, or romantic, like whatever kind of story it is, and whatever kind of audience that you're reaching out to, there's a different definition of interesting. At the most basic level, interesting usually means surprising and memorable. Surprising is the thing that gets people to stay tuned and stay in their seats, and then memorable is the thing that gets them to come back for the next installment. So, like this bald, crazy supervillain turning into Dolores Winters is surprising. Trying to kill the strongest man in the world for issue after issue is memorable. And so basically that's why 80 years later, I'm standing here and I'm talking to you about them. And so these three different versions kind of keep clattering along and throwing up sparks. And different ideas that are coming from like the comic book and the strip and the radio show are all sort of end up merged and backported back into what becomes like the actual story. So in the comic strip, they finally use the name The Daily Planet, and then in another strip, they use Metropolis for the first time, and so those are cooler names, apparently, than The Daily Star or Cleveland, and so then that becomes part of, like, so once that happens, like, not long after, then those words start appearing in the radio show and in the comic book, and so everything kind of merges towards the most interesting thing. And then there's flying, which is super weird. When people think about Superman, like the first thing that you think of is that he flies. But he didn't fly at all. For the first 5 years of the comic, he just leaped. It's like leaping tall buildings in a single bound. That was supposed to be impressive for us. That was enough. There's actually stories where like he has to go someplace really fast, and the caption says that he's like taking these huge like 700-foot leaps, like from coast to coast. He's leaping along. And doesn't fly. On the radio show, they just decided straight up, no, dude flies. Like, this is ridiculous. We cannot deal with leaping. And the radio show actually was the first version of this that wasn't written by Jerry Siegel and drawn by Joe Shuster. You know, they were taking care of the comic book and the comic strip, but they didn't know how to write radio shows. The radio show was written by a different guy. And clearly, they just decided that leaping is super boring. We have a wind-rushing machine that can make this awesome sound. And they came up with a catchphrase, up, up, and away, and it's super easy to imagine him flying, and so he just flies from like February 1940 on, and it takes more than 3 years for them to finally get to that in the comic book. In like late 1943, and when they first try, it looks super awkward, like they're still not sure, like after 5 years, like how that would look if he flies. But eventually they get there, sort of really December 1943. Like now, here he is, Superman, flying convincingly as he destroys a neighborhood of skyscrapers. He really does do that more often than he should. The other thing that happens with the radio show is that there is characterization for the first time. Ta-da. The comic book and the comic strip didn't have that and apparently didn't need it for a while. You know, you could just have, like, for example, if the first panel in the comic is an editor who says to Clark, Clark, go and get this story, and Clark can say, righto, and then he's gone, and you don't see that character anymore, it doesn't matter. They don't really need him to be a character except just a point. But on a radio show, if you're going to do that story, and you have, like, that's a person, that's a dude that you're paying, and he expects to do more than one or two lines, it's not worth it to pay the man. So it's actually the same, exactly same environmental pressures that radio soap operas had. Radio soap operas was invented like around the same time that also was radio and was daily episodes. And they also had like the same constraints of you pay a certain number of people and those people fill the 15 minutes that you have. And so like for soap operas, it established like the fact that is true to this day, that the way that soap operas work is something happens, and then everybody talks about it for like 3 weeks. And that's kind of also what happens with Superman, because it's the same thing. Like they can't, there's, in the comic book, there's like all this visual spectacle to look at, but on the radio, they kind of can't describe it, and then really most of the episode is people talking about how nervous they are. And so they had to kind of create better, more richer characters so that they have something to do. So Lois, was problem number one. This is Lois, like, pre-radio show. I absolutely loathe you, you contemptible weakling. Don't you dare even to talk to me anymore. This is not scalable. We cannot hire a professional actress who to come in and play a character who can't stand to be in the same room as the main character for more than like 15 seconds at a time. So they had to start writing stories where, like, from the beginning, they were sort of wary of each other. They were kind of rivals. She kind of was disdainful about Clark, and obviously sort of impressed with Superman. But it was a much warmer relationship, and then after a while, they go through adventures together, and so Clark and Lois sort of, like, it becomes warmer over time. So that's February 1940. So this is 39. There's only four stories with Lois in 1939. In 1940, this is once the radio starts, there's 20 stories with Lois in it. And from around June, so this is June 1940, it's about 4 months since the radio show starts, and all of a sudden, poor Clark's injured and I'm going to help him. And she's not like going out just like step on his face, she's gonna help. July, my gosh, can it be that I've misjudged you? In August, what a fool I've been if I had only listened to Clark. So we're seeing like dialogue and characterization that comes from the radio show gets backported into the comic book. So to kind of illustrate this emerging story structure, which then becomes like the story structure for a while, I wanna walk through issue number 7 of the Superman comic book to kind of see how that works. It starts with Perry White telling Clark Kent that there is a big story brewing in Gay City and Clark needs to go and check it out. So Clark obviously says, you bet, takes off his clothes and says, I may not only find a big news story in Gay City, like next stop Gay City as far as Superman is concerned. And Lois says, I want to get in on this Gay City action. And Perry tells her that Gay City is no place for a woman. And so she just gets into a taxi because she's like, no one's going to keep Lois Lane away from Gay City. I'm sorry. So like, I'm a child. I'm so sorry. But the point remains, this actually is the issue where you see this story structure for the first time that lasts for decades of Clark is gonna go do something. Lois says, why can't I do that? Because she's feisty, quote unquote, she's feisty. So she wants to go and do it too. And they tell her not to, and that makes her completely determined to go. And she like discovers things and investigates stuff and uncovers clues about whatever's going on. And then she gets into trouble, and then Superman has to come and rescue her. In some ways, she's actually kind of the main character of the show. And Superman is the guy who like is the deus ex machina who helps. Also, in this issue, in November 1940, that's Perry White for the first time. Before this, the editor, that like, the guy who appeared in like the first panel and just said, go do this, that guy's name was George Taylor. But like with Flying, when the radio show was building its cast, George Taylor is a super boring sounding name. And so they changed it to Perry White, and then that's a more interesting name, and that becomes the name of the character. Perry White becomes sort of like this comedy character, comedy relief character in the radio show because he doesn't actually go out on the adventures very much. He just, he'll say, like, go and do this, and they're still talking about it for like 2 minutes, but he's not gonna actually go. So he's sort of like irascible and grumpy. He has this funny relationship that develops with him and Lois and Clark, where he'll fire them and then like hire them back 2 days later. And is really cute, and now that's a character that we have. And then Jimmy Olsen was very similar. Jimmy Olsen was, he's the copy boy at the Daily Planet. He first appears a little bit into like the end of 1940, and he's like just a copy boy. He's basically just an excuse for Lois and Clark to get into this adventure. His mother is getting bothered by a protection racket, and so he reaches out to Clark to help, and now we're having a story about a protection racket. But it's a cute name, and he had a cute voice, and it just kind of worked. And so Jimmy Olsen like appeared in some other stories, and after a while, they just kind of got used to him. And so now that's a character on the show too. So again, all of this stuff is just on the radio show, and then kind of gets put back into the comic. The radio show's amazing, by the way, as I'm telling you. And so then, like, so these are now the characters. So by the time it's 1948, and you make a film serial, it's Clark and Lois and Jimmy and Perry, and then by 1952, when they make a TV show, it's Clark and Lois and Jimmy and Perry. And actually, in the 52 TV show, Jimmy Olsen becomes like the most popular character, which is weird for us because he's not anymore. But at the time, like again, really like a cute, funny actor, and it's a good role. And so in 1954, they gave Jimmy Olsen his own comic, Superman's pal Jimmy Olsen, and it ran for years and years, was very successful. In 1958, they gave Lois Lane her own comic, Superman's girlfriend Lois Lane. And so like that's how popular Jimmy Olsen was. He was like 4 years more popular than Lois Lane. Now I'm talking as if the radio show, like just everything that they did was gold. I've been doing that because I've been like sort of cherry picking out like these four characters that actually worked. There are actually tons and tons that they introduced that did not go anywhere. So shortly after like Jimmy became kind of part of the team, there was like another tough little kid named Pug Flanagan, and for a while it was like Clark and Jimmy and Pug. And then he sort of like, they couldn't really do much with him, kind of drifted away. In 1941, Clark and Jimmy went to Comanche country and had an adventure, and they met a cowboy named Tumbleweed Jones, who was like just a funny like comedy character. They thought he was great, and so they brought him back to Metropolis, and then they have this cowboy in Metropolis for the next year of stories who like gets into scrapes, and then we have to have, you know, some kind of solution to that. There's a police inspector that they try to make happen for a long, long time. He just doesn't happen. In 1946, they actually made like this huge, obviously intentional effort to expand the supporting cast. They just had like in every story, there would be a character who would then recur in a later story. There was like Professor Twiddle and Chicky and Muggs and Horatio Horn and Candy Meyer. Like if this was 1946 and you were 10, you would know every single one of those names. Tried them all out in 1946 and none of them clicked. And so kind of looking at it now sort of from a distance, it's really easy to figure out why, which is that Clark and Lois and Jimmy and Perry have a reason to be in the same room with each other. They work there. And Superman is basically like a soap opera office comedy with occasional dinosaurs. And so like there's a reason for them all to be. So like something, a story starts and like you just send whoever happens to be there, which is one of those four people. Whereas like with Tumbleweed Jones, they had to keep coming up with weird mechanics for like why we're including a cowboy in this adventure as well and what he brings to the team. And that's why he just sort of fades away and everybody forgets about him. So again, why do you know Lois Lane and not Lori Lamars? The answer is that Lois Lane, like I said, you know, she's there on the scene, and you can do a ton more with a Lois story than you can do with a mermaid story. Because we've been, like, for the last 8 decades, there have been all of these, like, all the stuff that I mentioned, plus, like, tons more, especially as there's, like, more and more media, lots and lots of, like, different variations on the Superman story. So imagine, like, that was your job. Like, you have to write 50 Superman, different Superman stories every year for the next 80 years without ever stopping. The thing that is not helpful to you at that point is a blank page. You need some kind of hook, you need something that's gonna give you an idea for what to write a story about. And so basically like Lois Lane is way more story productive. Like if we have, you know, this reporter who's, you know, Clark's in love with her and she's in love with Superman, sometimes she suspects that he is Superman, and you know, she gets into trouble and she investigates stuff. Like you can do anything with that character. There's like hundreds of stories, which is what they did. You know, and Lori not as much. And so Kryptonite is another thing that came out of the radio show, because the radio show's awesome, where it's another like super story productive thing, where it's this glowing green metal that is the only, it comes from outer space, it's from the planet Krypton, and it's the only thing that Superman's vulnerable to. For one thing, just the visual hook of it is awesome, and great that they thought of that on the radio show, because then when it gets into the visual media, it still looks awesome. But also just the idea of this really rare thing that is the only thing that can hurt Superman, basically, you can write like 100 stories just based on that. Like, how do they get it? How do they find it? Who knows about it? What does Superman do? Does he know that people have it? Are they gonna like sneak up on him with it? There's all these stories. And so that's why we have like Kryptonite stories in the world. And then also, so this whole story productive idea is why there's such a thing. Like if somebody says, how about Crypto the Superdog? Then rather than a blank page, you go, sure, okay, so now we have Crypto the Superdog in the show, or in the comic book. So there, again, real thing, there really is Crypto the Superdog. There is also Streaky the Super Cat, And I've mentioned before Beppo the super monkey and Comet the super horse. And all four of them, you put them together and they make the Legion of Super Pets, which is now a fact about Superman that you know. So Lois Lane, like I said, like, you know, she can go almost anywhere and do almost anything. If the story is like government corruption or aliens or a kryptonite threat or there's a weird monkey with a cape, like whatever it is, like she can go and investigate. She has a reason to get in there. And that makes her endlessly story productive. Whereas like Laurie Lamarus is a fish and there's just not that many places you can go with that. All of them below sea level. Like at a certain point, you just like, you towel off and you just go home and try to move on with your life. So now we're getting into the 1950s, if anybody's got a time check, mid-1950s now. The other thing that was happening, along with sort of Batman and Superman and like DC Comics kind of going, there's the other big thing is horror comics or like shock comics. So this is EC, if people know this. EC Comics was famous for like the really shocking, awful crime stories. And they were really into having really like amazing covers that make you both really want to buy the issue and really like uncomfortable and sad. So this is actually like this is the example that I got off of Google Images that like I was comfortable at all showing to you guys. Like everything else was like a guy with his hands like literally like locked around a woman's throat and squeezing, or like holding a guy's head and there's like blood and neck juice dripping off. That's like the cover of the book. And so that was on the same comic racks as Superman. And so people took exception to that as, you know, that feels natural to me. But then 1954, this madman named Dr. Frederick Wortham, who was a doctor of nothing, decided that these like horror and shock comics were really bad for kids. That if kids read, or even just be exposed to the covers of these horrible comic books, that they will go astray, they will drop out of school and become juvenile delinquents and commit crimes, none of which is the case. But as you guys know, like fake news is, if it's interesting, people will believe it. And so there was, in the mid-50s, like people were having like comic book burning parties. And people were like worried about, well, like what about the Donald Duck comic? Like, is that okay? And they would have these conversations. So the comic book industry did the same thing that the movie industry did a couple decades earlier, which is that they made up a completely fake rating system that they administered themselves and that didn't actually mean anything, but made everybody feel better. So like that's why there's like, you know, G and PG and R and X movies. That's something that the movie industry decided to do themselves so that they wouldn't get regulated by the government. So comic book industry does exactly the same thing. They have this comics code seal, totally fake. And having the comics code seal means that this comic is good for kids and won't turn them into juvenile delinquents. And so for Superman, it starts to go into this area where like, these stories are now really, really written for 10-year-olds, and they sound like they're written by 10-year-olds. The editor, Mort Weisinger, had this sort of amazing, like, complete aesthetic that I really, like, this is a period of the comic that I really, really love, and it's awful. So I'm actually going to veer off topic for, like, a minute, just because I have to show you some, like, 1958 Superman. So this was the period when, like, Supergirl first started, and she's popular. She's, you know, she's got a TV show now. Lana Lang, who showed up in, like, Smallville, Bizarro, and Brainiac, and, like, so there's some of the people you know, and then a lot of them are just, like, people you have, you know, and then there's the Legion of Super Pets. So just kind of to understand this, like, 1958 aesthetic for Superman, you got to start with Jimmy Olsen's souvenir collection. What that is this prized thing in Jimmy Olsen's house, this cabinet, where like when he and Superman go on adventures together, whatever souvenir there is, he can go back. So like, remember when like they threatened our lives? Remember when somebody was just about to kill you? And then here's the ceramic unicorn that was part of that. And so he takes it home and like he puts ceramic, you know, he makes a little label that says like ceramic unicorn from the time I almost died. And they all have like these little labels on them, as you can see there, like what is it, invisibility belt and diver's helmets. You know what a diver's helmet is? And kids loved this because that would be what you would do if you were friends with Superman and went on adventures. You would collect stuff and then like have your own little museum and put little labels on them. And so that aesthetic just basically becomes everything that happens. So there's always little labels on everything in the late 50s. Seriously, like there's always little labels on everything. And then, you know, the other big piece of the aesthetic is this clubhouse, this Arctic clubhouse that they invent for Superman, which is the Fortress of Solitude. Only he can get into it, obviously, because that key, which is in the Arctic, is a mile long. And it is so heavy that only Superman can lift it because the material that it's made from comes from a white dwarf star, obviously. And then inside is his secret clubhouse. When I was 10, I made drawings exactly like this of my dream house that would have like these little bubbles, and then each room is like a thing that I love. It'd be like a video game room and like a Muppet room, obviously, and then like a cat room. And so Superman has exactly the same thing, except for the criminally insane. So he's got like a space communications room, the bottle city of Kandor, where he has like friends living in a glass jar. There's all kinds of stuff. And the Superman of this period is like super exhausting. I kind of love this about him, but it's so bothersome. Because it says like, even a Superman must have hobbies. Super hobbies. For example, he's making this painting now to enjoy some painting. This isn't the result of my imagination. It's a realistic picture of a Martian landscape as observed by my telescopic vision. And it's like, of course it is, Superman. That's awesome. You can't just paint something. And like, he doesn't have a swimming pool like people. He has molten lava that he swims in, because that would feel awesome if only we could all do that. He doesn't ride horses. He has to ride this dinosaur that I brought back from another primeval world. Like, of course you did. And then the diary, his diary is like my favorite thing in the world. So much here. He doesn't write it on paper like a person. He writes it on metal plates that he constructs himself from something. And he writes it using laser beams shot from his eyes. And that's not actually even the thing. The thing is that if you're close enough to see, he says, like, today, the stuff that I write in this diary can never be seen by any other person. And so I am going to write it in Kryptonian, a language that only I understand. And then everything from there on, like those last four or five lines, are all like little Kryptonian symbols. And it's, oh my God, seriously, you are so exhausting, Superman. Like, why do you do these things? And then it's just so much harder. And so then the secret wax museum. So now, like the thing that I showed you from before totally makes sense, right? Because you understand this aesthetic. That like he has a Lois Lane room and a Jimmy Olsen room in his collections. And so he has to like make weird wax sculptures apparently himself and label them. And so that's where you get, like, that's why he makes a wax figure of himself and of Superman and labels it with Clark Kent's identity. Although, obviously, that is, like, a super dangerous security hole. Same thing with his wax sculptures of Batman and Robin and their, like, civilian identities, and then Supergirl and her civilian identity, and they're all, like, labeled like you do with, like, you know, Batman, Bruce Wayne's secret identity. Again, huge security hole, and that's why in these panels, Superman is attaching bombs to the legs. Those are little bombs that he's putting on the legs of each of these wax figures so that if anybody comes in and like might see those figures, then automatically they will explode, which is what happens while he's testing them. Which means that now he has to go and make like 25 more wax figures of all the people that nobody can see and put labels on them. And why do you even need these things, Superman? God, you're exhausting. But this stuff is, oh, also, I'm sorry, I thought I was moving on. No, the moon. He thinks he's dying in one story, and so he writes a goodbye letter to everybody on the moon. It's like, Superman, lay off the moon. You know, like, leave the moon alone, if you wouldn't mind. And then he doesn't die. And so we still have that on the moon. And the Jimmy Olsen and Lois Lane comics are also from this period. They're really insane. Thank you. Because the other that thing that's part of this aesthetic is that the covers have to be, like, crazy and arresting and has to, like, kind of capture people, and so you just write stories just to have like a really weird cover. For Jimmy Olsen, that usually meant getting turned into stuff, so like a Wolfman or Godzilla or whatever, so much that there's this comic, The World of Doomed Olsons, where he's on a planet with four other versions of himself, like changed into the things that he was changed into in previous issues. I don't actually understand it, but don't you have to buy that book? And then like Lois Lane comics were even weirder, like this one, which says, like, why is Lois Lane lashing a wooden puppet of Superman? And like when we get right down to it, like if we're really honest with ourselves, why is Lois Lane lashing a wooden puppet of Superman? Like, it's a really good question. And so, like, so that's basically, like, that's what that period is about. No real reason to show you this. Blah, 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 natural selection, right? Like, the other, okay. I'm sorry, I'm not even done. That Brainiac, the spokespeople, that's the other thing. I just can't do a talk about Superman and not tell you these things. Brainiac is shrinking down cities and putting them in little glass jars. Like you do, and so this is him doing that to Paris, which has elected a spokesperson to say, Sacre bleu, what is that cone of peculiar rays striking the whole city, which is amazing, for two reasons. Number one, sacre bleu, and number two, you're in the middle, you're looking up, all you see is light, how do you know? And then, like, the same issue, like, help, giant tweezers ripped the George Washington Bridge loose, says the spokesperson for the community of people living on the George Washington Bridge at that moment. And then, this is actually, I'm sorry, I should set it up more. Supergirl, so now there's a different issue, like Supergirl, her origin is that Krypton exploded, but some people still lived. And so this is that. Spokesperson says, our street of homes is being flung free into space, saving us from the concussion that wiped out all others. Our street of homes is being flung free into space. Again, obviously, I love it so much. Like, for one thing, again, total situational awareness of what's happening on the currently exploding planet that I am on, of, like, what happened to everybody else. And then also just that phrase, our street of homes is being flung free into space. Like, when I get old, I may forget the names and faces of the people that I love, but I will not forget our street of homes is being flung free. Like, that is coming with me. Wherever I go, it's coming, because I can't let it go. So Natural Selection, 1978. They make a Superman movie that's like the first big reboot. And the thing that's interesting about these kind of big, like, do-over reboot moments is that this is where you find out, like, who's actually important. If somebody says, like, there's no super monkey in this movie, this is not a real Superman movie. Like, that doesn't happen. And so they did, like, interesting thing here, in 1971, they actually made Clark Kent into a TV reporter, and then they did a survey to find out what people remembered. Obviously, what people remember is that he's a newspaper reporter, and so it's just this, like, really direct example of how the audience, in this ancient truce between author and audience, the power that the audience has to say, we will listen to your story, but Clark Kent is a newspaper reporter. So again, in this, it's like Clark and Lois and Perry and Jimmy working at the Daily Planet, fighting against Lex Luthor, who at the beginning is not bald, and then at the end is, just to make, like, everyone feel happy and complete that now it has, like, come back to the thing that we expect. And then the same process happens every time Superman gets rebooted somehow, which happens again and again and again and again and again. And so basically, like, you have all of these iterations and all of these reboots, and it's hard sometimes if you really like something, if you like a serialized narrative, like, if it starts over or it gets rebooted or remade, it's sort of hard for fans to, like, to accept the new one. But basically, like, what Superman history tells us is that the more iterations that there are and the more retellings, the stronger the ideas get and the stronger that story gets and will last forever. So if right now our current Superman snaps people's necks, and kills them at the end of the movie, and that's the awesome movie thing, like, even if that's happening, at some point, thinking long term, we're gonna come back to the Superman that everybody knows and recognizes, because that's the truce with the audience. Like, we will accept this only if you give us the stuff that we want, which is Clark and Lois and Jimmy and Perry working at the Daily Planet. Superman can fly, he fights Lex Luthor, and he's generally a good-hearted and positive hero who possibly might knock your house down. And, like, that will always be true, like, 10 years from now, And that's not because that was the original version of this story, because it absolutely 100% was not, but it's because after 80 years of natural selection, that is the version of the story that works. Thank you very much. Krypton is doomed. Thank you. Thank you so much.